So we're not quite done talking about our little crystal set. I think we can look at some other aspects of the crystal set. In the second part, we're going to go over what it takes to tune the antenna to give the maximum performance from the crystal set. You can see I've got another device here. We're going to go into this antenna tuner device. Also, I caught a little bit of flack on the last video. As you remember, I was using a little audio amplifier called a boomer. The boomer is a single chip, sort of an operational power amp where you can set the gain by just changing the value of a couple of resistors. And guys were kind of making fun of that, and they said, "Mike, you should have used a tube type amplifier with your crystal radio." So, being shamed into that, I did produce a small amplifier using a couple of pretty famous tubes. And we'll go through that amplifier as well. Let's get into a short review of what we covered in the first video. First of all, we learned that the crystal radio has a tuned circuit up front, and it really is a tuned transformer. It has a primary, which connects to the antenna and the ground, and it has a secondary, which is resonated by a variable capacitor. It forms a very high selectivity tuned circuit. It allows you to select between the various stations that you want to pick up. It also has some taps on it, and we use these taps for two purposes. First of all, we use the taps to be able to cover the high end of the broadcast band and the lower end of the broadcast band. And we use the taps to connect the diode to a lower impedance point on the tuned circuit, thus giving us the maximum selectivity with the receiver. Now you remember we were talking a little bit about how we need an antenna that's between 75 feet and 130 feet long in order to pick up broadcast stations from hundreds of miles away. We need to have a decent antenna. One thing I learned in the Morgan book is, beyond just having a good antenna, you need to be able to tune that antenna. And by tuning the antenna, I mean matching the antenna to the crystal radio so you get the best power transfer into the crystal radio means louder output and more stations. So what I've done is I've wound another coil, and this coil is called an antenna loading coil. It literally makes the antenna tune to various frequencies on the AM broadcast band. So all it is another coil that's approximately 200 turns of wire on a similar 1-inch dowel, and I have a slider so I can vary the number of turns that are connected in series with the antenna. So if we look at it, we come in from the antenna into the loading coil, out of the loading coil, and into the crystal radio. Let me show you how this works.
If what she's saying is true,
yep.
I've now mistuned the coil away from that station. Here's another. So as we tune lower in frequency, we need more and more of the coil to resonate the antenna. Going lower in frequency, I need more of the coil. Coil, higher frequency.
Hey, you're gonna love the call from Coach. To the right, to be
so you get the idea. The loading coil doesn't need to be in the circuit at all when you're at the high end of the band with my antenna because it's so long. But when we go to the low part of the band,
the band
Sam is being cared for at the National Institutes of Health outside Washington.
Almost all of the coil at this low frequency, around 600 kilohertz. So now you get the idea of an antenna loading coil. It can make a huge difference with the crystal radio. So the first thing we got to do is drill a hole through the ball that's going to comprise a slider for our coil. And believe it or not, you can drill a hole through a steel ball. Wasn't as hard as I thought it was going to be. Once we've got our coil form prepared, we're drilling a couple holes at each end. Remember, when we decide to put this between the two supports, we want to make sure that we don't drill right into the wire that we're going to pass through the coil. So we want to go each side of that wire. And then we're going to want to wind wire onto the coil form. Now, you might recognize the toolbox that's on the bench. That's called a Boy Scout toolbox. It's a typical woodworking merit badge toolbox design. And I've got one. I got a couple of them around here from both of my kids going through Scouts. They last forever. Anyway, that's going to comprise my coil winding arrangement. I'm going to put the number 24 wire right on the dowel. As you can see, I can pull that wire off, and it's going to come right off that dowel once I get the dowel situated. And I'm going to build up some tension on the line, or on the wire, so that I get a good tension to wind the coil. And then we're going to start the coil winding. Now, of course, you don't have to use a dowel. You can use any type of rod, and you can suspend it between a pile of books or something. But the idea is you want a very easy situation that allows the wire to come off the bottom of the spool, and you want to be able to keep it nice and tight when you're winding that coil. That's going to be our next step. What we've got here is a stack of books, and I've folded the wire into a piece of paper. I have the spool so that it can reel nicely off the dowel that I'm using as the mandrel. I've got my coil form here. I'm going to pass the wire through the coil form. Okay, and then just twist it to the side. And then we start our winding. And you simply count as you go if you want to, or in my case, I'm just simply going to wind as much wire as it takes to get to the other side. Okay, I'm about halfway. Everything's still going nice and smooth. No hiccups yet in winding the coil. So I sort of overestimated here. So I've stopped the coil about two-thirds in the middle. I could have continued with a shorter antenna. You might want a few more turns, but in order to resonate the 130-140 foot wire that I have, this coil will allow me to tune the entire AM broadcast band. Again, what we're going for is a slider that's going to come across and give us a variable inductor for our coil. So I've taken a piece of tinned number 10 wire, it's copper wire, a brass brazing rod would be a lot better than this, actually, and that's what the ball is going to slide on. And it's going to go right on top of the coil form like this, and slide back and forth. You could also mount it on the front if you set it proper, but I decided to go on the top. Now, in order to make the ball contact the coil in an even manner, I'm going to be pushing down on the wire with some homemade springs. There's it's a repair kit for faucets, and it's got all kinds of interesting springs and doodads in. I'm going to try to use some of those springs. So I found a couple springs that look like they'll work okay. Put some washers on there. Then run some screws down through there to adjust. Another washer on top. I should have something that's going to work. So now we want to get rid of the enamel on the area where the ball is going to contact. So we gently begin taking off some of the enamel. You'll notice I've prepped the coil. By putting this tape on each side, it makes sure I don't slip too much with the sandpaper. And once you've roughed off most of it, you can clean it up a little bit with some finer sandpaper. Okay, that should give a good contact surface for that ball to ride on. Good progress on getting through the enamel and just into the copper. Then we will clean that up with a little bit of alcohol. We should be ready to go. Okay, I'm just going to turn the amplifier on. Now, the tubes that I selected for this amplifier are interesting. I used the 1U5 battery tube and the 3V4 battery tube. If we go into the RCA handbook, we see that the 1U5 is a sharp cutoff pentode. It has quite a bit of gain, and it also has a small diode, so you can use the tube actually as a diode detector. We could actually replace the diode detector with the diode section of the 1U5 diode sharp cutoff pentode. Also, we can see from the book that it runs on 1.4 volts as far as lighting up the filament, and it only takes 50 milliamps of current to light the filament. It can run on pretty low voltages as well. The voltage that I'm running the tube on are 4 9-volt batteries. 4 9-volt batteries, that's 36 volts DC on the plate of the tubes. No way to get a shock on a circuit like that. So we take the gain of that amplifier and we put it into the final amplifier stage, which is the 3V4 pentode. It's a power pentode, and it's capable of putting out 270 milliwatts if you happen to have 90 volts on the plate, which we don't. We only need a few milliwatts to drive this small speaker. I got rid of that monstrosity 25-watt car speaker and replaced it with a small speaker in a box. So let's light the filaments by taking the 1.5-volt battery and putting it in place, and then attaching the lead of the 36-volt plate pack.
Why would I leave unexposed an area this close to my neck and my nose? And she said they had no response. So this leads into the next soundbite here. So let's listen to this last one, what she has to say about that.
So that's what a small tube amplifier sounds like hooked up to a crystal radio. And we'll go through that circuit. It's a very nice little circuit, completely low voltage. You can't hurt yourself. And it's every bit as effective as the little chip, but we're talking about two small peanut tubes.
We're using two tubes, the 1U5 and the 3V4. These are both battery tubes. That means they're tubes that were developed during the 40s and 50s for battery radios. Very interesting tubes that don't actually have cathodes. They're directly heated filaments. The 1U5, directly heated pentode that has a diode that's used for a detector. And the 3V4 power amplifier tube. 3V4 looks just like any power pentode, but no cathode. So these things were used in a lot of projects in the 40s and 50s, and you could make all kinds of little goodies using these tubes because they were such low current drain. One favorite project was a one-tube regenerative receiver. I built one of these in high school. It worked out very well. It's a beautiful tube to use for a regen. Just have to make sure that you've got the 1.5 volts to light up the filament, and you've got the 45 volts or so for the plate. Although really you can run it on anything from 24 probably to 90 volts by putting some 9 volt batteries together or using a bunch of battery clips. You can make your own supply. You know, a lot of these AC-DC power supplies, like you find on printers, are fairly high voltage. Some of them are 24 to 45 volts. This AC supply off an old Kodak printer is 36 volts. It works beautifully for a B battery for the receiver. If you really want to get fancy, put a small regulator off that, and you can make the 1.5 volts for the filaments as well. The MAB, or the Marine Airborne, was a chest pack radio that utilized the battery tubes. And the old BC611 handy talkie developed by Motorola. Portable radios in the 40s and 50s utilized these tubes. A lot of these were very small sets, could be taken to the beach or on your bike, and you'll see these sets usually had 4 or 5 tubes. The king of the portables, of course, is the Zenith transoceanic receiver. Some of the Grundigs and Telefunkens also were pretty wonderful portable radios using these tubes. But most of the circuitry involved using 4 or 5 of the tubes, similar to an All-American 5, but with the battery tubes. And they're very effective receivers. Again, there's a big advantage to only having 50 milliamps on each filament. So let's take a look at our amplifier. We start with a potentiometer, that's our gain control on the input. Then there's a 10 meg biasing resistor. Notice the diode is grounded because we're not using the detector diode in the 1U5. The 1U5 has been strapped into triode configuration just for simplicity, and we don't need that much gain. And then the 3V4, he's got an interesting bias arrangement using R4 and R5 and a voltage divider that actually brings the grid up to the negative bias we need for Class A. Remember, with no cathode, you can't really do cathode biasing unless you used independent filament batteries for every tube, and we're not going to do that. Any audio output transformer used for small All-American 5 type radios, especially the ones with the transformers nailed right to the speaker, make excellent transformers. You're going to need something that will transform 3,000 to 6,000 ohms down to 4 to 16 ohms. So a typical audio output transformer will work nicely in this circuit. The other thing we have to be concerned about is we're building the circuit on a wooden board. So the chances of having a lot of hum pickup without any ground plane or without any shielding is there. So if you get a lot of hum, think about your grounding. And if you can, build this into a metal case, you will get better performance. Looking at the parts list, we have a pretty simple parts list, really. And at the end of the parts list, I've got some substitutes for the tubes listed. Some of these are European tubes, and you can look in some of those old radios and find some of these tube types and try them in this circuit.
Okay, so we've taken the crystal radio one step further, adding the antenna tuner and a small vacuum tube amplifier. You might note that the amplifier has a little more gain than we had set up with the little solid-state amplifier. And that is true. The gain is set a little bit higher because we have the volume control. We could have done the same thing with the solid-state amplifier. In the next video, I want to go through something called a wave trap. A wave trap is a device that's useful when you have interfering stations, like when you're in a metropolitan area or you're in an area where you have a strong station that's only a few miles away. It allows you to kind of null out that station. So we'll see how that works. We're also going to hook up that little diode section of the tube and try to replace the germanium diode with the diode in the vacuum tube. That'll be an interesting experiment. And finally, we're going to build the the ultra crystal set topology, which is called a loose coupler. We're going to make a loose coupler for the broadcast band. I think you're going to be pretty impressed with the performance.